How are you tonight, Bob?
I'm good, thank you.
I thank you for joining us
on
this Monday night. It's an honor to have you in here, and we appreciate spending part of your Monday with us, Bob. We just, for about the last 10 minutes, we've been talking about the Olympics in general, mainly the 68 Olympics. We'd like to get that into that with you a little bit, Bob, first of all. About you personally, going into those Olympics, Bob, I know you had gone to USC, you had won four NCAA titles, here you had won at the Pan Am Games in 67. Here you're going into Mexico City, Bob, high altitude, but you were kind of, you must have been confident, but did you really think that you could have some amazing success and put your name on the map like you did?
Well, you know, when you compete in track and field, you get used to competing in a lot of competitions, and just making the United States Olympic team is probably a bigger challenge than competing in the Olympic Games, because we are so blessed with so many great athletes in this country, and I certainly was not a shoo-in, although I was the favorite, I guess, but just making the team, I was more nervous just making our Olympic team than I was competing in the Olympic Games.
Bob, looking back, the training for it and everything, the high altitude, was that hard on the track athletes at all? Do you remember?
Well, I think on the longer distances, the endurance events, it had some effect, but it certainly had no effect on my event, the pole vault, or, you know, maybe some of the shorter events. Bob Beamon had no problem with it in the long jump.
Yeah, we were just discussing that.
Talking about Bob. Yeah.
He had that mark that stood for 23 years. Bob, my co-host Tony D'Angelo has a question for you.
Yeah, Mr. Segrin, it's an honor and a pleasure, and thank you so much for appearing
please.
With us.
Call me Bob, please.
Thank you, and that's a bigger honor. In looking back in 1968, now I was 12 years old, and kids of my genre, we really hooked on to you guys. We hooked on to you. We hooked on to Bill Toomey. We hooked on to George Foreman. Of course, we all like Debbie Meyer. But, before all of this started, there were some incidents in Mexico with the students at the university, and there was some rough stuff happening there. And there were some things involving the black athletes that maybe they'll perform, maybe they won't perform. What was happening in your mind? Was this unsettling to you and some of the other athletes there?
Well, the student riots were very unsettling because, you know, you make the Olympic team. It's, you know, for most athletes, it's a once-in-a-lifetime shot. And when I remember reading and hearing about, and, of course, watching on the news, the student riots and you know, the students being shot and killed, and like, oh my goodness, you know, my biggest fear was they were going to cancel the Olympic Games, and you know, naturally I felt bad for for the students that were killed, but you know, you train long and hard preparing for something, and you hope to get there, and then if some, you know, thing, something out of your, totally out of your control has a chance of taking that away, it's very unsettling.
I can't say I know how you feel. I can only say that I imagine.
And Bob, we were discussing some of those tremendous athletes at those 68 games. He had mentioned Toomey, Foreman, Dick Fosbury, Bob Beamon, Meyer. Being part of a team like that with so many athletes, how much interaction did you have with a lot of these other people that went on to win gold?
Well, of course, you know, I mean, the track and field athletes, you know a lot of them because you travel to Europe with them, you get to know them, you compete regularly with them, and you see them at competitions, and, you know, you don't always have a choice over who your roommate is on some of the international travels, and so it's kind of fun. I got to know a lot of them, you know, quite well, and I was fairly young. I think I was 18 years old when I took my first international trip, and it was quite an eye-opener. That was summer of 1965, I believe, and it was a lifestyle. You said, man, I could do this for a long time. You obviously enjoy it, but so you do get to know those individuals, and you certainly are thrilled when they succeed, and then when they don't, you feel the pain. I mean, Jim Ryan was a close friend, and certainly I felt the pain for Jim here. I thought this guy was invincible. There's no way he's not going to win you know, the mile run, or and you know, and the problems he had in two Olympic games. But so, and then, you know, and then other people. My roommate in Mexico City was Jeff Vanderstock, who was a 400 meter hurdler, and he set the world record at our Olympic trials. And I thought for sure he's going to win the gold medal in Mexico. And he goes from first to fourth place in the three steps of the race. That was devastating for him and for me, you know, my roommate.
Bob, FYI, we just had a picture of you on the screen at age 13, circa 1959, and it looked like a guy that had his eye on the gold already at young of an age. But we'll have to get you a copy of that. But moving on, Bob, of course, one of the big things of that Olympics, first of all, about your performance itself, I guess you cleared 17 feet, 8.5 inches, and I believe that was your mark at both of the Olympics, believe it or not. It was good for gold in Mexico, and I guess it was the silver at Munich, but right. What do you remember about the competition itself?
Well, it was the competition, you know, obviously your first Olympic Games, you're not sure of everything, and it was a long competition. I think we competed for like 8.5 hours. My memory is correct. We started right around noon that day, and I don't think we finished until like 8:30 that evening. It was a long competition, and you know, you warm up and you take your practice jumps before noon, and I don't think I took my first jump in the actual competition until like, you know, 3:30 that day, some 3.5 hours later. So you know, you cool down, and then you got to warm up all over again, and you hope that you're on and your step is right and everything works. I think I took a jump at like 3:30, and then my second jump didn't come until like 5:30 that day. So that's a long time in between.
I always felt that way about pole vaulters, especially a lot of waiting around.
Sure.
You know, once you make that, it's such an important, every jump is so important. So it's a lot of waiting. Tony.
Yeah, Bob, we're into the Olympic Games, and you know, the activities have started, and you know, of course, at least to me, one of the iconic, there's really two iconic images to me as a very young person in 1968 in those Olympics, being Smith and Carlos with the Black Power salute, and then later on George Foreman waving the flag. George, at least in reading, said, "I wasn't making a statement. I was really saying truly how I felt." The undercurrent of, shall we call them, the social issues at that time, how was that affecting you, the other athletes? What were some of the discussions going back to the village at night? Did you have any conversations?
You know, it was interesting, and we had our there was, leading up to the Olympic Games, a number of major competitions here. There was an effort underway by certain individuals. I think Harvey Edwards out of Berkeley was trying to get all the black athletes to boycott the Olympics. And, you know, of course, in the rumbles of that go around, and most of the athletes that I talked to, black athletes, the general opinion was that, man, this is a once-in-a-lifetime chance for me, and that's a pretty big price to pay. You're asking me to do something. And so I think it was pretty much general consensus that, no, we're not going to boycott amongst the black athletes. But and it kind of died down after the first Olympic trials at the Coliseum in Los Angeles. After my recollection is that kind of died down after that. And then at the Olympic trials, the final Olympic trials at South Lake Tahoe, I don't recall much talk about a black boycott of the Olympic Games at all. I think everybody was so wrapped up in, you know, trying to
competing,
make a name for themselves, and you know, and what shoes they were going to wear, and how much money you could make under the table. That sort of preoccupied most of our thoughts, I'm sure. But but then in Mexico City, I mean, I knew nothing about it until it actually happened, and then, you know, then the rumblings in the village afterwards when John and Tommy, and you know, I had, you know, somewhat conversations with them over the years about it. I don't think I spoke with them directly probably until, you know, months after the Olympic Games, and had a chance to, you know, maybe reflect on it or chat. But I don't think anybody that I'm aware of disagreed that there is social injustice in this country. It still is today, but
yeah, it's true.
But I don't think they meant to be disrespectful to the United States and certainly to the national anthem. And I think raising your hand and lowering your head during the playing of the national anthem was misconstrued by, I think, a lot of people, and they paid a price for it. But you know, it was nice to see on television the other night at the ESPY Awards where they received the Arthur Ashe, I think, Humanitarian Award, I believe it is.
I believe that's right.
And it was really nice to see the you know, the reception that they received and the ovation that they got. And here, you know, two nice people. I mean, I know them very, very well. Good people, and certainly not bad people, and not terrorists, not militants or anything else, but two good people and athletes that trained and worked hard and to try and to achieve a goal like any of us.
You're watching Monday Night Sports Talk here on CTV 14. On the line with us, the great Olympian Bob Segrin, gold medalist of the 68 Olympics. We'll move on to 1972 now, Bob. Of course, those games were marked by the unfortunate Munich massacre where the Palestinian terrorists took the 11 Israeli athletes hostage. Two died in the village while the others passed away, Tony, in transit.
Yeah.
Where were you exactly when the hostage drama started, Bob?
Well, I'd say, you know, you reflect back on your life and how different things could have ended up or turned out. I finished my competition the day before this all happened. And
I recall.
I was with a friend of mine, a gentleman by the name of Buddy Williamson, a pole vaulter out of the University of Maryland. And he was actually staying in my room with me in the Olympic Village, even though he wasn't on the Olympic team. So he was able to come in and out. So security was there, but it was definitely was pretty loose. And Buddy and I, when I finished my competition that day, I actually was playing foosball in the rec center with the Israeli women's track coach and one of the athletes. And I don't know if he was a weightlifter or a wrestler, but we played foosball until about 10 p.m. and we walked out with them, and they walked down to their building, and ours was about two buildings down from where the Americans were, and we said goodnight, and I went to bed and got up at 6 a.m. and left the Olympic Village. I had rented a van. I was going to tour Europe with my parents for a couple of weeks, and I left, and they are the two that probably walked in that evening, and one of them, I believe, if I got the story correct, was killed that night. And his body was found on the steps the next morning when everything became apparent that something was wrong. And so, you know, and you always went to somebody else's room and kind of hung out for a while and talked, and you just, you know, you don't know what would have happened if Buddy and I would have gone down to their room that evening for a while. So,
and it's amazing.
Sad story.
Exactly, Bob, and it's amazing the success that some of you people did have in spite of all this. Tony.
Yeah, Bob, you know, I could remember now at this time I was about 16 and I was in a baseball tournament far away from home. And pretty much when we loaded in, you started your event against Mr. Nordwig of Germany. And we all started cheering for you because we were so scared. It was just like you were like a familiar face. You meant a lot to us. And during this event, if I understand it correctly, you had your pole, the catapult, which was, and again, you know, please correct me if I'm wrong, which was agreed to for competition until you got there, and then it was decided that you couldn't use it. Could you elaborate on that in that event?
Well, it's very technical, and it's hard. It's hard unless you're a pole vaulter and understand how pole vaulting poles are measured and weighed and measured based on strength. It's pretty tough to understand, but basically, vaulting poles are made just like anything else. They're different thicknesses, which leads to different flexibility. So, you know, you have to pick a pole that is the right length and the right flex for your body weight and how fast you run. So it is very technical. So you can't just say 170-pound pole fits everybody. I mean, there's so many different degrees of a pole in let's say a 170-pound test pole. There's probably 15 or 10 to 15 poles within that have different ratings by very calibrations depending on how high you grip and how fast you run and how much you weigh. So it is a very technical thing, and the pole vaulting poles were basically two manufacturers back in those days, both here in the U.S., and both of them came out with, whether it was marketing or whatever, but they came out with new poles that year, and basically the only difference was color. There was a tiny bit difference in weight based on the manufacturers, the way they manufactured the fiberglass material. So, but the weight difference was so insignificant. I mean, you're talking about an implement that weighs about 6 pounds. If you hold a pole vaulting pole in the middle and just weigh it, it weighs about 6 pounds. And the difference between the old and the new pole was maybe 50 grams difference in weight. Well, 50 grams is, I defy anybody that can pick up a 6 pound implement in each hand and tell me which one is 50 grams lighter. I mean,
Ted Williams, maybe the rest of us. No.
Yeah.
That's about it. Right?
It really is minuscule. So there was some controversy over these new poles were supposed to be lighter in weight and an advantage. So they banned them at the early part of summer, and then they realized there was probably no basis for this, and the ban was off. So then we arrived in Munich, of course, and then the ban was back on. So I didn't know what was going to happen, so I went to Munich with six of the newer poles, and I went with three of the old style. And then they issued the day before the qualifying round, they said all vaulting poles, vaulters in the pole vault, their poles had to be in the stadium by 5 o'clock or whatever on that evening. Well, I was out with my parents and my family travel, looking around sightseeing. I came back to the village after 5 o'clock and I noticed my vaulting poles were gone. And they told me what happened. They said, "Gee, they issued an edict today that all the vaulting poles had to be in the stadium by 5 o'clock." When I went, "Oh my God, I've got three more poles down in the garage on my car," so. They said, "Oh, well, you better get them over there quick." So I drive over to the stadium. I take the three poles in, and in the stadium was Adrian Pollan, who was the head official for the pole vault, and he's in there telling me that he's going to decide which poles are legal and which ones are illegal, and I'm going, "Okay, well," I said, "this is interesting." I said, "Well, I had three more poles that I had in the garage that the officials didn't know, so I want to drop them off so you can." I put them in. He said, "Fine," and just told me to drop them over here. And he started, and then I asked him, I said, "Well, how are you determining, what poles are legal and illegal?" He said, "We're going to weigh them." And I said, "Well, weigh them, what does that mean?" He goes, "Well," so he starts to explain. And he had a scale, and he was taking the tape, and there's a rubber plug in the end of the pole, and they were removing them, and they were weighing vaulting poles. So he would see on all vaulting poles are marked 170 pounds, and then they have a flex number, like 6.2, 6.5, 6.7, or whatever. And that's the strength range within that 170-pound test. It's very technical.
That was...
So he's saying we're going to weigh them to see which ones are legal. I said, "Well, where's your criteria from the manufacturers that says 170-pound pole should weigh between here and here?" And he goes, "Well, we don't have anything like that." I said, "Well, how are you going to determine what a pole should weigh? We know what we're doing. We know what we're doing," he told me. So he takes a pole, let's say 170-pound pole, and he weighs it, and it's 6 pounds something, whatever. And then he takes one of the new ones, which you could tell by color, and he weighs it, and it's a little bit lighter. And so he goes, see, and he's all happy that he proved his point, And I go, "Okay." I said, "Well, weigh another one." And he happened to pull one out of the pile that was the old color, which supposedly is a legal pole, and he weighs it, and it's lighter than, by a few grams, lighter than the one that he said is illegal.
Jeez.
And I looked at him, and his face just turned beet red, and I said, "Well, I guess that blows that theory." And he got so angry with me, he said, "If you say one more word, I'm going to throw you out of the competition for unsportsmanship conduct." And I just looked at this guy and I went, "This is bizarre." And I literally turned around and walked out figuring, "Oh, this is crazy. I'll have my three poles. I'll have my three legal poles to jump with in the morning." And when I showed up in the stadium the following morning, they had masking tape on the wall where your poles were, and I went down and found Sigrun, and
It was empty. They had taken all 9 vaulting poles away from me.
Unbelievable.
Well, we're glad you, first of all, we're glad you stuck around, Bob, because you did win a silver medal, and so that was great.
It was kind of bizarre. Yeah, it really was bizarre, but very technical, and but I wasn't the only one affected. I think 17 other vaulters of the 20-some vaulters that were in the competition were affected. And, you know, just as much as I was.
Well, just another obstacle to overcome in a tough Olympics, Bob. And, of course, let's fast forward a little bit here. We know after your Olympic days, you went on and you actually became involved in that Superstars competition, which I loved as a teenager.
Oh, that was so much fun.
When it first came out, I thought it was such a novel idea. In 1973, you ended up being the inaugural winner. You're going against some of the best athletes in the world.
Of that time.
How did you get involved, Bob, and how gratifying was it to come out on top?
Well, you know, that really was a lot of fun, and I tell you, to be honest with you, I got more notoriety and recognition from Superstars than I ever did from pole vaulting, that's
sure.
for sure. But,
yeah.
You know, I remember reading about it in the newspaper, and this concept of Superstars in Florida, and I had turned professional after the 72 Olympics, so I figured, well, no problem, I'm a pro athlete now, and they started that pro track circuit that lasted 4 years and died a financial death. But I called the organizers. I got the information from the newspaper, and I called them, and I said, hey, I'd be very interested in participating. And I was politely told, thank you, we have our name athletes, and, we'd be happy to put you on a waiting list. So, about another 2 months went by, and I pick up the paper, and Bill Shoemaker was one of the original athletes in the Superstars, and
wow.
So I'm reading the paper one morning, and I read where Bill gets thrown from a horse and breaks his wrist.
It's not funny.
So I'm on the phone immediately saying, hey, there's an opening, what do you think? And of course they politely told me that they had other fill-ins ahead of me, and
it's really amazing.
And,
I remember like it was yesterday, Bob.
I do too.
The 10 events, and I specifically remember you in the obstacle course, the rowing and everything. You still had the muscles. You still look great. And it was just amazing because obviously you weren't the most popular athlete there, and you saw your name right at the top, and it was really something for America.
It sure was.
To see.
There was no question I was probably the most unknown athlete there, but but yeah, it was so much fun. It was great, and I probably realistically I was probably in better shape than most of the athletes there. And they brought people in for television draw. Johnny Unitas, Johnny Bench, John Havlicek, I think Elvin Hayes, and Joe Frazier, and who else was in there? Rod Laver.
Yeah.
I mean, there was a lot of legends of their sport that was certainly people were going to tune into, and this little unknown pole vaulter came in there and stole the prize money.
And Bob, we got about 2 more minutes with you. I want to mention you got involved in acting after your competitive days. You were in, for those out there that weren't familiar with your acting career, you appeared in shows such as Dynasty, Falcon Crest, Fantasy Island, Soap, Wonder Woman, a lot of the ABC shows. Was it a natural progression for you, Bob? Is it something you always wanted to do?
I never crossed my mind. I came home from 68 Olympics and got a call from a couple of agents, and they said, hey, you ever thought about doing this? And we'd like to represent you, and you could make a killing, and da-da-da-da. And I went on a few interviews, and I got a couple commercials, and it was easy, fast money. And then I thought, well, what? Why not? So I took some acting lessons and kind of stuck it out for a while, but it was a lot. It was fun to some degree, but great money when you're working. How much they pay you for sitting around on a set most of the day, but it just wasn't it wasn't charging my batteries. I just didn't get the thrill out of it. It wasn't feeding my ego. So I guess I always had a.
You like the gold medal better than an Academy Award, by
the way. I don't know. I got to occupy my mind, and I got to have a challenge facing me. And the acting wasn't doing it, although, I think there's a lot of tremendous great actors out there, and they approach it probably a lot differently than I did. But I had my ego trip with athletics and no regrets and had a lot of fun, and it was a lot of fun doing the acting stuff. But I enjoy business today. I enjoy taking challenges and risk, and knowing that I'm not going to hurt anybody other than myself if I make the wrong choice. So. Mm-hmm.
About a minute left with Bob Segrin on Monday Night Sports Talk, Tony.
And Bob, you know, that's really a perfect segue to what you're doing now with the International City Racing. Can you tell our folks about that?
Well, I've always been involved in business, even when I was acting. I opened a travel agency. I had restaurants and doing different things. I had my own marketing company, and I was a VP of executive VP of Puma for almost 10 years, Puma USA, back in the mostly through the late 70s and early 80s, and I left and kind of opened my own marketing company and was always looking for something new and challenging, and the opportunity to get into the running business. I was kind of kept aware of what was happening with the marathon and the running industry, and had the chance to take over the Long Beach Marathon, and I put a company together, and so now we do the Long Beach Marathon. We've taken that from about 4,000 people up to 18,000 people today.
Definitely
in 8 years.
Yeah.
So we do a marathon, half marathon, 5K, and we have a bike tour, and we also now took over the Orange County Marathon. We operate it with a management contract, and the inaugural Pasadena, California Marathon this November. So we do a number of other running events, the Dana Point Turkey Trot out here. We do a huge open water swim. One of the fun things for me is that open water swimming is a new Olympic sport in Beijing this summer, and where they swim a 10K. That's 6.2 miles.
Oh, boy.
And it's being called the marathon of swimming because it takes them about 2 hours to swim it, very similar to the marathoners who take about 2 hours to run it. We are a World Cup event on the World Cup Tour for 2009 here in Long Beach with open water swimming. So I enjoy the event business. It's fun, and it keeps me in athletics.
We wish you continued luck with that. Bob Segrin, National Track Hall of Fame. Bob Segrin, who's posted 8 world bests between 66 and 69. Multi-Olympic medalist and Superstars champion. Bob, we're out of time, and we're honored to have you on the show.
Let's not forget, great guy. Thank you so much.
A tremendous pleasure having you on here, and please keep in touch. And thanks for coming on tonight.
Thank you so
much. My pleasure. Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
Take care, Bob.